Share something that I'm hoping to share probably for the next several weeks. I really want us to get more and more established in grace and what Jesus did, because I find that unless that foundation is so solid in your life and my life, we try to apply things from a self perspective instead of a God perspective. And this is from Paul Ellis's book, The Gospel in 10 Words. And I just thought it was an excellent story. I just want to read it to you. I may read it for the next several weeks. I don't know. But it says, a guy that he'll call Jake wrote to him, wrote to tell me he loved God and wanted a relationship with him, but didn't know what to do or how to be saved. He said he had heard from some religious people that God expects us to live a sinless life and that he won't approve of us if we go dancing with friends and that sort of thing. At this point, you may be thinking, how misguided. Dancing is not a sin. I know. It's laughable, but don't miss the bigger issue. Christianity is not a list of do's and don'ts. Christianity is Christ. The point is not whether dancing is on your do list or your don't list. The point is whether you have any list at all. Rule-minded people are preoccupied with doing good and avoiding evil, but this is carnal religion. It's eating from the wrong tree. Christianity is not a test. It is a rest. And see, I think that's so amazingly powerful, because how many times do we fall back into that where, you know, people, is it all right to do this or not this? And it's not even about that. It's about a relationship with God. It's about Jesus. It's about focusing on what he did. See, religion, man's religion, will focus you on what you're doing or not doing. True Christianity focuses you on what Jesus did. And the more we focus on what Jesus did, the more it will change what we do. But see, unless you're so grounded in that, you'll be knocked this way and knocked that way. Amen? Now, let me show you something here. I'm debating on if I should start with Romans or Hebrews. Let's just start with Romans 1, 16 and 17. I'll just start there. I have so much to say. I just got to calm down. Hallelujah. It's so good. You know, if that's the problem you have is being overloaded, that's an awesome problem. Amen? It just never ends. The goodness of God just never, ever ends. It's the most exciting life on the planet to be a Christian. I'm so excited that I'm born again, that I'm a child of God, that I'm a walking, talking manifestation of Jesus. So are you. You just got to say yes to it. Amen? Amen. See, that's the fight of faith. It's the fight that you are who he says you are in him. That's a fight. Amen. That's what makes religion so dangerous, because man's religion will point you to you. True Christianity will point you to him. Amen. All right. For I am not ashamed, I love this, of the gospel of Christ, the good news, the almost too good to be new, good news. It's almost too good to be true good news. It's so good. But notice, I'm not ashamed of it. In other words, I'm not backing down from it. You know, sometimes because of the abuses of people who interpret grace as just a license for the flesh, there's a temptation to back down. You can't back down. You have to preach it hard. It's about Jesus. That's Paul had the problem in Romans 6 when he said, should we sin that grace may abound? God forbid. Certainly not. That's not what I'm saying. He had to deal with that because some people don't... they don't understand that God got you out of sin to get you into a life empowered by his grace. Amen? He didn't set you free to sin. He set you free from sin. There's a difference. Changed your nature, if you will. For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believes. Now, salvation in the Greek is not just... when you die and go to heaven and don't go to hell. That's just one part of it. Salvation is deliverance. It's protection. It's safety. It's health. It's all those things are a part of salvation. Did you know that? We've talked about that before. That's all salvation. But notice what's the power of God unto or into salvation. The gospel. That's the power. Amen? The gospel's the power of God into it. In other words, it's believing that I am right with God because of Jesus. Now, let me say this to you. And I love saying this because this is one of the reasons, I say this often, so get used to it. that I appreciate communion so much. I really appreciate it because it just to me, it's an act of faith that puts my focus on Jesus and what he did and off of Chris and what he's doing or not doing. And I need that. I need that. I do. I need to jerk my chain because we all need it. I'm using me as an example because this world will focus you back on you. See, that's the minute. You know what the ministry of the Holy Spirit is? To show you Jesus in the Word. To show you who you are in Jesus. That's the ministry of the Holy Ghost. Amen? He's not the Holy Ghost was all over me, man. I'm really... The only sin he convicts you of is not putting your faith in Jesus. Amen? He convicts the world of sin, of righteousness, and of judgment of sin because they believe not on or into me. Amen? And let me tell you something else about this grace gospel of Jesus Christ. It's not something you receive on a one-time basis. It's something you have to consistently, constantly receive. Amen? Because if you don't, then the world comes back in and starts telling you it's about you again. See, that one of the things that makes... That's why it's important to be... To have to be in the gospel gear, if you will. Because I've seen sometimes people will preach something and it's gospel and then they go right back because that's what mixture is. Amen? Now watch this. For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone. Notice it says not everyone, but everyone that believes it. Amen. To the Jew first and also to the Greek. Next verse. For therein is the righteousness of God revealed. The gospel does not reveal the sinfulness of man. That's what the law did. Amen? God gave the law to one nation, Israel, but it condemned the whole world. And even the Gentiles or the nations who did not receive the law like the Jewish nation did were still under the law. You know, how many times have we heard stuff like this? Well, I just got to make the man upstairs happy. Anybody ever heard anything like that? You're like, well, I just want God to be happy. I used to work with a guy, and he was like, well, you know, as long as you keep, you know, 7 of the big 10, you're pretty good. Like God grades on a curve. I got a 70, D minus, but I'm in. That's not how it is. The Bible says in the book of James, you know, if you keep the whole law and offend in one point, you're guilty of the whole thing. In other words, it's either perfection or you need a Savior. And nobody could be perfect. See, that's why God gave the law. Paul said in Romans chapter 7, I would have not known lust except the law had said, thou shalt not covet. I wouldn't have even known what it was, Paul was saying. But the law came and condemned me and showed me my wretched condition as far as a human being and that I needed the Lord. But see, the church has come along and said, no. You just need to keep these rules. You know, we'll say things like, well, you don't keep the Mosaic law or the law God gave through Moses, but then we have our own laws. And as long as you measure up and do whatever we say is that, then you're good. And it's wrong. Back to the statement, it's not whether dancing is on your do list or your don't list. It's some of you, it needs to be on your don't list. I'm kidding. We don't want to see you dance. I'm teasing. But it's whether you have a list at all. You know, I get a kick out of people from my hometown. It just cracks me up. And I've said this before, too. In fact, I was talking to a guy recently, and he says, now, you don't drink beer anymore, right? I got 3 cases in my... No, I'm kidding. I love to offend religion. Thank you. Like my friend Ted Nelson, if you're listening, Ted, from Wisconsin, he just loves to offend religion. He pastors a church in Wausau, Wisconsin, and he's like chief bartender at the Grace Station. Cracks me up. I think it's funny. But you know, that's the mindset, is that, well, you don't do this anymore and you do this because you're, quote, religious. And I hate that because that's not even what it's about. You know, people aren't even seeing you. They're seeing, what can you do and what can't you do? It's not anything like that. It's all about knowing him. When you know him, it will change your behavior. Amen? Because you're in love. How many know when you were in love with your spouse? Hopefully you still are. But when you were in love, you just like, you, it was just, You did things, special things. You spent time together. You enjoyed being with each other. Amen? You know, that's the way it is in Christianity. That's the way it's supposed to be, because you're in love. And seeing that, once again, that's what the Holy Spirit does. That's why it's called the newness of spirit. He keeps everything that Jesus has provided fresh in your life, fresh in your experience. Amen. For therein, the gospel, everybody say the gospel, is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith. Notice the gospel reveals the righteousness of God, not the sinfulness of man. I got to let that, you need to marinate in that. Because most people, help us preach the gospel. And I'm thinking, you're not preaching the gospel? My friend Ramin, that's one of his dreams, is to get a Farsi, which is what they speak in Iran and other places in the world, Farsi-speaking network into the Middle East. That's all New Covenant preachers. You know why? Because he deals with them on Skype a lot. And he says they're confused. They hear a gospel grace message, and then all of a sudden they hear, you know, 10 of them that are confusing them and putting them back under legalism and mixture. And he says it confuses them. So he has a dream, and hopefully we'll be involved in that dream of all New Covenant preachers. He's already talked to Andrew Womack about it, of going into the Middle East with all New Covenant preachers into Iran. You know, revival's exploding in Iran. You know, there's people that are coming to Jesus. It's the government that over there that's a mess. But there's a lot of people, like I think it was Ramin told me, he says that they hate Islam, the most of the citizens, because it's repressed and oppressed them. It's religious. Praise God. I didn't mean to get off on that. For therein, in the gospel, is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith. I love this. As it is written, the just, those who are justified, shall live. Everybody say live. You know, that's a condition of life. We shall live by what? Faith. Faith has an object. And the object of our faith is Jesus Christ and what he did. Amen? So the just shall live. And the word live isn't, notice it doesn't say, notice what it does not say. The just shall exist. Doesn't say that. There's a lot of people that are existing, but they're not living. God hasn't called you and I to exist. He's called us to live. I see people, and you do too. We all do. And sometimes we can even be this way because we're in this world. But, you know, we don't have to be. And, you know, you could just, I can look at people, and some of them, I think, man, life's really slapped you around. You know, life in this world has slapped you around. You know, God has a better way for you and I. God wants us to live rejoicing because of what Jesus has done. And this is why I emphasize the ministry of the Holy Spirit, because you cannot grasp the things of God, hear me, outside of the Holy Ghost and him quickening it and making it real to you. Quickening it. Blah, I can say that. All right. So the righteousness of God is revealed in the gospel from faith to faith, as it is written, those who are justified shall live by faith. Now, Romans 5:17. I can see I'm not really getting to my message, but we're moving. It's all good, people. I'm telling you, hear. I beseech you, I beg you, don't receive the grace of God in vain, is what Paul said. 2 Corinthians 6:1, I think it is. For if by one man's offense, referring to Adam, one man's offense, death reigned by one. Do you know since the fall of man, death has reigned in this world? Did you notice? Have you noticed? Have you watched the news? Right? There's a lot of negative things going on. What is that? It's death. Because of man's sin. Because of Adam's sin, it just allowed death to reign in this world. Much more. Oh, I love that. Much more. Everybody say much more. Much more, they which receive the abundance of grace. Now that received there is in the present tense. It's ongoing. Notice that those who receive the abundance of God's ability given to us on an unmerited, unearned, undeserved basis. Notice, much more they who are receiving not grace but the abundance of grace and of the gift of righteousness shall reign in life by one Jesus Christ. So what is our part? Receiving. Now, Message Bible, verses 18 and 19. I just want to show you this and then we'll be in Hebrews 12 and hopefully we'll get to the message. Hallelujah. Watch the Message Bible verses 18 and 19. I love this. Here it is in a nutshell. I love that. Just as one person, referring to Adam, did it wrong and got us in all this trouble with sin and death, another person, the man Christ Jesus, did it right and got us out of it. But more than just getting us out of trouble, he got us into life. See, the church, while I'm out of trouble, now I can go do what I want. He got you into a life. Amen. The most exciting life you could ever imagine. Hallelujah. One more verse. One man said no to God and put many people in the wrong. One man said yes to God and put many in the right. Hallelujah. God became a man. Now, King James, Hebrews 12, 28 and 29. We are getting to our message. Hallelujah. Now, this is powerful. Wherefore, we receiving a kingdom which cannot be moved. Now, that's amazing to me. Talking about God's kingdom, it says we're receiving it. I thought we already received it. Is anybody listening? We have received it. That is our position. We are in the kingdom. But it says here we're receiving it. Present tense. Wow. Wow. You know what that's saying? Even though you received it, you continually receive it relationally. Amen? I'm married, but I don't receive the benefits of marriage unless I have a relationship with my wife. It's simple, right? But here's what I want you to see. Wherefore, we receiving a kingdom, present tense, which cannot be moved, hallelujah, let us have grace. Let us have is the Greek word echo. And I love this. Are you ready for this? It's present tense, continuous action, but here's what got me. Are you Greek scholars ready? You know, this is good stuff. Real good stuff. It's the subjective mood. You know what that means? It's contingent. It's dependent upon something. You receiving the kingdom is dependent upon you understanding grace. Now you know why I love the languages. Because you start seeing it. You receiving the kingdom is dependent upon you holding on to grace. That's what echo means, on a continual basis. You know how many people have the kingdom in their position as a son or daughter of God, but they're not receiving it because they're coming outside of the realm of grace and outside of the realm of the gospel? Glory to God, that's good. Now watch this. Let us have contingent present tense whereby we may serve God acceptably with reverence and godly fear. Leave that up there. Whereby we may serve, latrio in Greek, present tense, subjective mood. In other words, you can't serve God acceptably with reverence and godly fear. It's contingent upon you receiving grace. Can anybody hear that? See, here's what I'm trying to get you to understand. People have got this mindset, well, I'm in the kingdom, that's it. That's like saying, I made the football team, that's it. That's what the enemy wants us to believe. Amen? But we are in a fight of faith, not a fight to earn. We're in a fight with the lies of this world that says it isn't true. You know, that's why I encourage people, go, start going and finding people and shut-ins and praying with them and talking with them. Don't go because you want to see the power of God. No, 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 no. Go because the love of God is compelling you and you'll see the power of God. See, sometimes we go because we want to see lightning bolts come out of the end of our hands. Okay, I prayed for you. Get out of here. But when we go with the love of God compelling us, it's a whole different world. All right, now the message, Hebrews 10, 24 and 25. This really is the message. Why do church? Great question. Why is it even necessary? I can get it online. Yes, you can get it online, but it's different. It's different. I know people don't like this. You know, we live in an incredibly rebellious society. You know that. See, you know how I always talk about balance? People don't get it. You know, if you don't have God's true balance, you'll settle for a false balance. Proverbs 11:1, a false balance, not a balance, is an abomination to the Lord. Ephesians 5:15, see that you walk circumspectly. Circumspectly, one Greek scholar says, is right down the middle of the road. Amen? Come on, this is good. You got to eat your vegetables too. We need it all. Who wants to grow? You know God will offend your flesh because he loves you. I'm not talking about putting, you know, it'll offend. He is Lord, not me. See, when he's my Lord, he becomes my Savior. Okay, why do church? And let us consider one another to provoke unto love and to good works. Leave that up there. The word provoke, I've told you this before, it means to stimulate, never manipulate. Never. It's stimulate. It means to irritate. I love that. I call it holy irritation. Now, but if I take your hand or you take your hand and you rub like this, eventually it gets hot, right? Because you're rubbing, the friction causes you. Why? Because nerves are there. And when you rub your hand, the nerves that are in your hand will eventually, they'll be stimulated and your skin will get hot. See, but rubbing your hand doesn't cause nerves to come. You know what I'm saying? Nerves were created there. No, they're already there. You rubbing it simply stimulates what's already there. Here's where we've messed up. Notice it says, let us stimulate, provoke, unto love and to good works. The church has done come along many times and said, just do good works and forget about love. Notice the sequence or the order. It's love, then good works. Amen. That, you think, well, that's little. No, that's big. The Bible says, and I said it earlier, but it's in 2 Corinthians 5:14. It's the love of Christ that compels me. It's the love of Christ that compels me to consider someone other than me. The love of Christ for me will motivate me. You can tell your growth in the love of Christ by your desire to reach out to other people. Amen. Good news. See, Satan wants us to settle for a half truth. What's a half truth? God loves you. Now go out and overeat. God loves you. Go get drunk. No, God loves you, and he's changed you, and now he wants to work through you. The most exciting thing in life is that God works through me. I said it last week or the week before. I'm more excited about being a Christian than I am a pastor. And I love laboring in the Word of God and doctrine. But I'll tell you what, I love it when you can go minister to somebody, and you can go pray with somebody, and you can go love on somebody, and you can go manifest Jesus to that person. And every single one of us, that's who we are. So that's why it says, provoke to love, unto love and to good works. Not to good works, but to love and to good works. Amen? Now look at the next verse. Not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together as the manner of some is, but exhorting one another, and so much more as you see the day approaching. Why do we need the church? Now I'm going to read something to you from You Are the Church, I get all that. But let me give you the definition of church. Can I do it? I'm going to give it to you from Thayer's here. I think I got it right here. Ready? Here's the definition. Ecclesia. I used to always think it was just called out from the world. One day I was getting out of the bathtub and I heard the Lord say, look that up. So right here from Thayer's, come on, turn. It says, here's what it means. Ecclesia, a gathering of citizens called out from their homes into some public place, an assembly. It means an assembly of the people convene at the public place of the council for the purpose of deliberating. That's what it means. And there's other definitions, but it means to be called out. Human being. We live in a society where it's easy just to do your own thing and not interact with imperfect people. And all of us are imperfect in ourself. We're perfect in Christ. Amen? You know the challenge of your love walk. Where you're really walking at with God isn't how many scriptures you can quote. It's your love for the brethren. I can tell where I'm walking at when people rub me the wrong way and I still love them. Because it's not my love, it's the love of God. See, this is what the world's looking to see. There's so much rejection in the world. And when they see us rejecting one another, they think, why do I want that? They're no different than us. You talk about the power of God. And see, and I believe the best church growth technique and track you can pass out is when you go to people and pray for them. I love what Linda says. She'll go through a drive-thru and say, I'm going to be praying. Anything you want me to pray about. This is why I pray for boldness. Walk in Kroger and I look around. are you leading me to, Lord? God will lead you to people. And then you start talking to them and just conversing with them. And they start telling you, hey, I got this going on. I said, can I pray for you? It's awesome. Awesome. I want to live that way every day. There's no condemnation if I don't. All pressure is off. Jesus took all the pressure. No pressure. I did a post recently on most people don't even know the difference between a challenge and condemnation. We all need challenged. See, condemnation tells you, you sorry thing, you need to do this if you want to be something. That's a lie from hell. A challenge is, this is who you are. Come on, Johnny, you can do it. Amen? You can do it because of who you are in Christ. But see, that's when life gets exciting. God doesn't want us to just exist. Hallelujah. I love the Lord. I love Him so much. I love Him more and more. I love being with Him. I was out here early today, just drove out and got out here and just praying in the Holy Ghost and worshiping God and just having a time with the Lord. I'll tell you what, it's awesome. In His presence is fullness of joy. People are like this. God is awesome all the time. And He's awesome in all of our lives, all the time, right where we're at, no matter how bad things may seem to be going in the net outward. And God will turn it around if you'll stick with Him. Just make a decision. One of those things I love about the Old Testament guys, man, they messed up. But you know one of the things I've noticed? They never quit. They never quit. It's impossible for you to lose if you never quit. Amen. God wants us to be so victorious here. Hallelujah. So not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together as the manner of some is, but exhorting one another, and so much the more as you see the day approaching. Now I'm going to read this from John Nuzzo. He's a pastor in Cranberry Township, Pennsylvania, a Rhema grad. And this, I thought this was so good about church. Because you know there's a lot of criticism directed towards the church. You know that. A lot of armchair quarterbacks. Why didn't he throw them all there? Okay, big hot shot. You get out there with defensive linemen in your face and 200, 300 some pounders coming at you, and you try to get the ball off. I'm talking to me because I'm the one of the worst. I'm kidding. All right, here it is. It says, while I am all for making things better, I would suggest that the current trend of 5 reasons or 16 things or 9 conversations about the problems with the church or why people are leaving the church are missing the point. Every church is a unique representation of a collection of imperfect believers, imperfectly trying to reach their imperfect world for Christ. I have learned in life that those who set themselves as critics rarely ever build anything sustainable with their lives. When is the last time we saw a movie critic making a critically acclaimed movie? A critic removes themselves from active participation in order to stand and criticize. While I can pontificate forever about what is wrong with the way people raise their kids, conduct their marriages, etc., I have found personally that doing those things successfully and staying around through the imperfections are much harder when you are the person that has committed your life to them. Instead of sitting back and rendering judgments about everything, roll up your sleeves and make it better. I have searched my Bible and I can't find an office in the body of Christ called critic. When you stand before God, you won't be judged on your opinions and critiques, but what you did with the gifts, talents, and resources that you were given to reach the world for Christ. Oh, just for the record, I don't always like the pastor of the church I founded and pastor and lead, and wish he was a bit better at everything he is responsible to do in serving and leading others. I love a saying that my Italian grandfather used to say in his broken English accent, I see you in the church, I thought that was excellent. Amen. Why do church? I believe church is one of the primary, what I call, protection from deception. There's a lot of deception out there. And I know this, if you're truly called as a pastor, you are called to labor, not visit. Labor in the Word of God and doctrine. Sometimes I wonder why I warn people of the perversions of grace and these things, but I realize Cecil got me seeing this. It's because of your calling. You're called to protect. You care. And I thought, you know, that's exactly right. Because Satan hates you. Hates your guts. Because you're the object of Jesus' affection. And so the only chance he's got at you is to get you believing some corkscrew doctrine that's going to cause you to let him in and mess your life up. That's what his goal is. And I'm learning the more and more that sometimes we talk to people, and I used to just, I don't want to say this, but I've got to love people enough to tell them, even if they get mad. Because part of loving people is telling people the truth, speaking the truth in love. Amen. So why do church? Go to Ephesians chapter 4, verses. The first reason we looked at is to provoke unto love and to good works, but I want to show you that, continue that theme in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11. Watch this. Verse 11, some of you know this verse, and he gave some apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, and some pastors and teachers. Now leave that up there. This is what it said. These are talking about in the body of Christ. I have heard a teaching that says there are different types of pastors. There's apostolic pastors. There's prophetic pastors, evangelistic pastors. I'm not saying that's not okay. I believe these are individual offices. But notice they're in the church. They're in the body of Christ, right? And the Greek actually says he gave some apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, and some teaching pastors. That's what the Greek actually said. Just ask Greek scholar Kenneth Wiest. Next verse. For the perfecting, or the word perfecting means equipping. If you have a New King James or other translation, it'll say that. For the equipping of the saints for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. Now leave that up there. These gifts are in the church. They're in the body. Now, I know the church is universal, worldwide, but there's also a local body. Amen? All right, turn the tape off. some people, we need the body. We need the gifts. Man, I pray. You know I pray for you? You know how I pray for you? In the Holy Ghost. We'll come right back. Jump over to and we'll come right back here, but jump over to Hebrews chapter 13 and verse 17. 13:17, we'll come right back here. Watch this. Obey them that have the rule over you and submit yourselves, for they watch for your souls. How do they watch? In prayer, Colossians 4:2. As they that must give an account, that they may do it with joy and not with grief, for that is unprofitable for you. Hallelujah. See, in our society, because we've seen abuses. I've seen abuses in the body of Christ where, anybody old enough or heard about the shepherding movement way back? The shepherding movement was the belief that you had to ask your church leaders or your pastors who to marry, when to blow your nose. I'm exaggerating, but that's how bad it was. That is wrong. A true ministry gift will point you to Jesus and your relationship with him and not to them. Amen. See, that's what it's all about. But see, if we're having relationship with Jesus, everyone will flow. Everyone's got a gift. All right. So back to Ephesians 4, verse 12. So God gave these gifts to equip the saints for the work of the ministry. Now, this is what I love to say. One of those fivefold gifts, as we call it, is evangelist. I could pick on all of them, but I just want to pick on that one. Because when I think of an evangelist, you probably think the same way. I think of somebody either preaching at a crusade and people getting born again, or somebody on the street with tracts and leading people to Jesus. But notice the evangelist is for the church. Anybody got that? Why? The evangelist is for the church, to equip the church. Well, you mean the church needs to be born again? No, the church is born again, or they would not be the church. Why is it for the church? To equip the church to do the work of an evangelist. Amen? It's a gift that challenges and teaches us to do the work of an evangelist. You know, when I talk to you about going into nursing homes and stuff, I'm doing everything and with my God-given ability to encourage you that you're an able minister. You're as much a minister as any other person in the body of Christ. You have the resident power of God in you. Amen. I don't want church to be, we come, we have a church meeting once or twice a week or whatever, and then that's it, and then we go do our own thing. No, we're ministers. All right, for the equipping of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying or building up of the body of Christ. Next verse. Till we all come in the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God unto a perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. Next verse. That we henceforth be no more children, tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine by the sleight of men and cunning craftiness, whereby they lie in wait to deceive. That we're not children. He's talking to believers. Tossed to and fro by every wind of doctrine. Do you remember that thing down in, where was it at? Lakeland, Florida? A few years back, remember that? And all this stuff was going on. I remember I would watch that. And people were like, people flying down there. And God's moving here. And, you know, here is Christ. There is Christ. Here he is. No, he's right here. Because he's in me. He's in you. Come on. But they were going there because that's where God's at. That's where God's moving. And then it came out that there was all kinds of junk going on. No surprise. I remember watching it. You know what I thought when I watched it? No word. No word, flags. Come on, more, more. Stick them to the floor, more, more. Remember that? You remember the laughing revival? Remember that? I remember being in a meeting with some young guy that was a part of that whole deal. And I remember sitting next to him, and he would go, dude, you gotta go to the restroom? It's right over there. I remember that. He was like forcing himself to laugh. Weirdo. The Greek word for weirdo, weirdo. I think. Golly, I'm under a minute. What happened to the time? Okay. So this is that God doesn't want us to be tossed to and fro by every wind of doctrine. God wants us to be established in the Word. And you know, we are supposed to judge things. He that is spiritual judges all things. We're supposed to judge what people are saying. When I watched that Lakeland revival, God wanted me to judge it. Not saying they're bad people or, you know, they're going to hell. Not, but to judge what's going on, does it line up with the Word? And if it doesn't, reject it. Amen. But see, well, all Christians shouldn't judge. Judge not, lest you be not judged. Read that in context. We are supposed to discern. Discernment is the ability to interpret what you see and hear. Prove or test all things, 1 Thessalonians 5:21, and hold fast to that which is good. Amen. All right. Okay, and that's done. So let me try to hurry here. I got another clock down there. I want to give you another point. The number one reason we do church is to provoke one another unto love. Who is love? The love of God's been shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost. We're to stir one another up in this love that we have, and then good works. We cannot get that out of order, because if I try to stir you to good works without telling you the love of God's been shed abroad in your hearts, or you don't understand that, then you could go out and try, well, if I don't, God's mad at me. God is not mad at you. There is no pressure. If you don't act on any of this, there's no pressure. You deceive yourselves, according to James 1:22. That's why, you know how many people I've said over the years have said, oh, we need to see the power of God. We need some power of God in our service. And pressure's on the minister. Come on, do something. Okay. Fall over, honey. I'm serious. It's garbage. We're here to get equipped to go out there. Imagine if everybody prayed for somebody this week and they saw a manifested healing. Guess what would happen over time? We'd have to knock that back wall out or add services. That's what they're looking for. That's what they're looking for, and we have it. That's why I want to scream. Do something with it. He's saying the same things. God went with them, confirming the word with signs following. Notice what happened first. Sequence. They went. God went. Confirmed the word. Hallelujah. 43 minutes. I'm just about done. So that provoke one another to love and to good works. If you don't stay stirred up, you settle to the bottom. Amen. Okay, now with that said, I'm going to try to do this one quick. Number two, to be reminded and taught to draw near because of his love. Now that may seem simple. Hebrews chapter 3, verse 12. Watch this. Verse 12, you need to be stirred up and reminded to draw near and not pull away from God. I don't care who you are. I don't care how much you know, how much you've heard the word, heard the message. We all get times where we tend to pull away because we're looking at us again and we're thinking, you know, he challenged me to go minister to somebody and I didn't do anything. So what? Amen. God, just draw near. Draw near. Be encouraged. Take it as encouragement. Take it as a challenge, but encouragement. But God loves you. I know it's intimidating. That's why Paul prayed for boldness. Every day, say, Lord, I have noticed when I go somewhere, if I'll ask God for boldness, it's there. But if I don't, I find myself intimidated. It's like clockwork. I find, well, are you a Christian? I don't know about that. I'm kidding. I don't do it. I'm not that bad. But you know, I notice when there's a boldness, I said, man, I told one guy the other week in Walmart, I said, listen, I prayed, Lord, lead me to somebody. I haven't got an opportunity to pray for somebody today. Lead me to somebody in there. And he asked for wisdom. It doesn't have to be a healing. He had a major situation going on in his life. And I said, God's given you this wisdom. And then I asked him, are you baptized in the Holy Spirit? I'm just blunt about it. Do you pray in other tongues for your own edification? Well, I really don't understand everything about that. Well, you need to. Amen? I'm not that hard. But I'm saying, you got to call it what it is. You know, they asked an umpire one time, what is it when you call a pitch? What is it? Is it a ball or a strike? He goes, it's not anything until I call it. That's the way life is. It's not anything until you call it. Call it. He gave you the authority. Use it. Hallelujah. God, I get so excited. Take heed, brethren. You know what that means? Be aware, brothers and sisters in Christ. Brethren, watch this. Lest there be in any of you an evil heart of unbelief in departing from the living God. Now, this does not mean, hear me, this does not mean you're going to renounce being born again. But you know, in our experience, we can depart from the living God and start doing things in our own strength. That's why it says, trust in the Lord with all your heart. Don't lean unto your own understanding. That's the temptation for all of us, is to lean to our own understanding, right? That's what he's talking about. Next verse. But exhort one another daily. Daily. You know what that tells me? I need exhortation. The word exhort, parakaleo, means to call near. To call near. To call near. God's not rejecting you. Call him near. Call him near. Daily, while it is called today, lest any of you be hardened. Leave this up there, please. Lest any of you be hardened through the deceitfulness of sin. There you go. If you sin, you're going to harden your heart. That's really not what this verse is talking about. The Greek says the deceitfulness of, are you ready for this? The sin. What is the sin in this context? The sin is a definite article. Sin is a singular noun. It's talking about the sin of going back to trusting in yourself. That's what he's talking about. That's what hardens your heart. He said, so exhort one another in this verse. Tell them to draw near on a daily basis. Draw near in your relationship while it is called today. Why? Lest any of you be hardened through the deceitfulness of the sin of trusting in me and not him. Whew. Next verse. For we are made partakers of Christ if we hold the beginning of our confidence steadfast unto the end. What was the beginning of our confidence? Just as we are, based on what he did. Next verse. We are made partakers. While it said, today if you hear his voice, harden not your hearts as in the provocation when they provoke God. For some, when they had heard, did provoke. Howbeit not all that came out of Egypt by Moses. In other words, they didn't all. But with whom was he grieved 40 years? Was it not with them that sinned, whose carcasses fell in the wilderness? Next verse. And to whom swear he that they should not enter into his rest, but to them that believe not? Next verse. And so we see that they could not enter in because of unbelief. God brought you out to bring you in. Into what? Into this abundant relationship that you have with him. You're out of Egypt, but enter in. Receive on a daily basis. Now, from the Amplified, and we will close. Hebrews chapter 4, verse 1, because that's the next verse. Hebrews 4, 1, watch this. Therefore, while the promise of entering his rest still holds and is offered today, let us be afraid to distrust it. You know, most of the time the Bible tells us don't be afraid, right? Fear not. But here it tells us to be afraid of something. Of what? Distrusting the promise. This is a holy fear. This is a holy fear. Let us be afraid to distrust this, trust it, lest any of you should think he has come too late and has come short of reaching it. Let us be afraid to distrust what he did, lest we think Not that it's a reality, but we think we've come short. How many times we've come too late or we've come short of reaching it? Well, I waited too long to get born again. God can redeem the time in 2 weeks. And you know, when you find out that abundant life is knowing Him. It's not about how big your business or your ministry or anything is. It's about knowing Him. That's abundant life. That's being content in whatever situation you're in. It doesn't matter what they think. It matters what He thinks. And He loves you and He loves me. Amen? He wants to show you that. Amen? So that's why we exhort or call people near on a daily basis, lest any of you of us are hardened through the deceitfulness of going back under self-trust. So why do church? Number one, to exhort one another and stir one another unto love first and then good works. Number two, to be reminded and taught to draw near because of His intense love for us. And I got a couple more. And if you think I forgot about 2 Corinthians 5, for those of you who took notes, I have not. Now, I want to challenge you guys with something. I promise you, you won't remember everything I said today unless you apply yourself. Promise. Promise. Take it to the bank. For you not to write it down or get a CD, which they're free. I'm not paying you to take them. They are free, though. That's as cheap as we're going. Okay? And to go over it or go online. Go over it. Just like what I said out of Hebrews 12, 28. I didn't get to 29, for our God is a consuming fire. You got to meditate on that, about how it's contingent upon the grace of God. If you don't meditate on that, you will lose it. And if you lose it, you won't use it. Satan loves it when we don't marinate in what we've got. Amen. I say that out of intense love for you. Okay? We got to apply ourselves. And let me show it to you. Hebrews 4, verse 2. We don't have to put it up. That's okay if you've got it shut down. It's from the King James. It said, the word preached did not profit them, not being mixed with faith in them that heard it. Faith is the hand that takes what has already been supplied by grace. Faith is an action that receives what's a done deal. Faith never earns. Jesus earned it all and gave it to us as a free gift. But faith takes. You know, the Bible says in John 4:14 that we have a well in us, a well of water. You can die of thirst and be right next to a well. Did you know that? If you don't know how to draw it out. Faith draws out what grace has been supplied by grace. So I encourage you with that. Say this with me. Say, I am blessed.
I am blessed.
And I am not going to be passive.
I'm going to take
what God has supplied by grace. Take it. Amen. You're blessed. Now, before we go, anybody here not born again? Mark's pointing to Teresa. Anybody here that you think's not born again? I'm teasing.